wild animals in South African game reserves. We hope that you will find as much enjoyment from it as we found in the researching of the information. It is a privilege for us all to be able to enjoy travel and to see and learn on our journey through life, enriching us as we go. The African elephant is recognized as the true king of the beasts. Larger than its cousin, the Asiatic elephant, it grows to a shoulder height of 3.6 meters and can weigh up to a massive 6 tons and has been known to attain an age of up to 65 years. The African elephant is the largest land animal in the world, having evolved over a period of 20 million years. Evolving from a much smaller amphibious animal, no larger than a rabbit, it progressed until mastodon, an animal with large tusks and a long proboscis or trunk. Its extinct cousin, the mammoth, was even greater, standing at a shoulder height of 4 meters. Some features of the elephant are worth describing further. The most obvious feature, the trunk or extended nose and versatile tool, is used for gathering food, sucking up water, smelling, guiding youngsters, trumpeting, breathing, and a versatile weapon. The ears, apart from being the organs of hearing, contain a multitude of subcutaneous blood vessels. These facilitate heat loss when the elephant flaps his ears. Flapping ears also fan the upper body. Blood leaves the ears between 8 and 9 degrees cooler than the rest of the body, thus functioning as an effective eliminator of surplus body heat. Notice the wrinkled skin, which helps in temperature regulation by presenting an increased surface area to the surrounding air. Elephants do not sweat and use the above in conjunction with water and mud baths to cool down. Mud baths also discourage insect attack. The teeth of an elephant are unusual in that the upper incisors grow forward and outward and so form what we know as tusks. Cheek teeth or molars are replaced from behind by new ones when they get worn and drop out. 6 teeth develop progressively on each side of the jaw, but only one set is in use while chewing. Tusks are also used as weapons for digging, prizing bark off trees, and for shaking grassy clods. An elephant may be right-tusked or left-tusked according to which tusk shows more wear. In juveniles, milk tusks are replaced with permanent tusks after about 6 to 12 months after birth. When challenged, an elephant will attack and attempt to pierce or unbalance its invader with its tusks. Tusks grow at a rate of about 10 centimeters a year. An elephant has no front teeth or incisors, as it is a vegetarian. The forefoot is slightly larger than the hind foot, although not as long. Soles of the feet are covered in thick padding, which prevents slipping on smooth surfaces. Pads also deaden the sound of walking in the bush. The foot spreads out when the elephant stands on it and contracts when lifted, thus facilitating removal from muddy ground. When an elephant walks, the legs on one side of the body move forward in union. A wounded knee or leg would therefore render an elephant motionless, an unfortunate fact known to both early hunters and modern poachers. They are very adaptive to a wide diet, thanks to their strength and height. They can shake down pods and fruit from large trees, and their height enables them to reach high leaves in otherwise inaccessible places. Their marvelously dexterous trunk can pluck tender shoots from the thorniest branches, reach upward into trees, and pluck grasses from beneath bushes. Typical elephant food includes grasses, marula fruits, mopani leaves, and bark, acacia seed pods, palm fruits, bulbs, and various other available greenery. Thorns on twigs are not a problem for elephants as long as there are some green leaves among them. The advantage of being able to eat thorny branches is that in very, very dry periods, these types of trees stay greener for a longer time, thus ensuring food for them. Smaller branches are cracked, chewed, and easily swallowed. Baby elephants often place their trunks into the mother's mouth while she is eating. This is the way that the baby elephant learns what is edible. Marshes are favorite grazing areas as vegetation is soft and palatable, and mud banks offer cool and refreshing coats of protective body coatings against sun and insect attack. Because of their large size and ineffective digestion system, elephants require large amounts of food. They therefore are seen continually feeding and consume up to 240 kilograms of vegetation daily. Their hourly defecation supplies food a host of other animals, birds and insects, who are often seen digging in large balls of elephant dung. Although very water dependent, they can go without for up to 3 days. Up to 9 liters of water is sucked into the trunk to in turn be piped into the mouth. Up to 100 liters of water are drunk during a visit to a waterhole. In arid times, elephants survive by digging into riverbeds with their tusks, so sucking up slowly oozing water in the deep sand. Elephants do not favor dirty water, and they prefer to wait for muddy drinking water to settle. These holes are jealously guarded by all elephants. Breeding usually takes place in the rainy season when the female reaches about 14 years of age. The cow leaves the herd with one or two attending females to calf. During poor conditions, maturity occurs later. After a gestation period of 22 months, one or sometimes two elephants are born. At birth, a youngster may weigh in at 120 kilograms, and the mother will suckle her calf for about 2 years. Once the calf is born, the mother often takes it to the rest of the herd to meet them. The other elephants all greet the new arrival with much excitement. Elephants sometimes adopt orphan calves, help injured elephants, and work together. The newly born calf can usually stand upright on its own within an hour of being born. The female breeds every 4 years according to appropriate and suitable available feeding. Bulls reach maturity at about 16 years of age. The survival rate for young elephants to reach maturity is usually about 1 in 3. Although the elephant does not have good eyesight, it has a well-developed smell and sense of hearing. One sometimes notices that the elephants lift their trunks up into the air to sniff and smell foreign smells in the wind, such as an enemy or other animals approaching. Elephants can also smell water for kilometers away. The continuous low rumbling sounds are communicative, calming sounds, like a cat purring. Stomach sounds are often heard when close to the herd. These sounds are said to travel vast distances over the veld and are similar to whale calls communicating with distant herds. Elephants are roaming animals and are constantly on the move, finding food and water en route. Many kilometers are traveled tirelessly daily. They are excellent swimmers and when crossing deep water use their trunks as versatile snorkels. They graze on average about 18 hours a day, mainly in the early morning and late afternoons and evenings. When the sun is at its hottest, it seeks shade under trees or bushes. The elephant is able to sleep while standing and often does so to mimic awareness to others. In South Africa, many railway lines and even roads have been built by following animal tracks over mountains to construct passes. Wandering elephants use the most practical route and gradient to reach their destination, an ability copied by man in later years. An attacking elephant charges at about 40 kilometers per hour. The most easily recognizable differences between an African and Indian elephant are the size of the animal and the fact that African elephants have much larger ears. African elephants became extinct in northern Africa by about 300 AD. Females wield the power in elephant society and herds are formed around cows and offspring.
Thank you.
white rhino. Do you notice that this animal seems to be built like a battle tank? The white rhino, also known as the square-lipped rhino, is the second largest animal living on Earth, after the African elephant. Despite its awesome size of 1.8 meters high and weighing in at 2.3 tons, this is basically a placid creature that is less irritable and more gregarious than its cousin, the black rhino. Groups of 4 to 8 individuals are led by a dominant bull. Being a grazer and not a browser, its flat or square-lipped, wide, flat mouth is able to crop grass to almost ground level. The term white is thought to have been derived from wijd, or wide in Dutch, as their mouths are often wide compared to the black rhino. And wide has subsequently been changed in history to white. There is nothing white to this creature. It is grey with overlapping thick skin on the shoulders and belly, making it appear like a reinforced piece of armoury. White rhino move to live in small groups, and sometimes individuals will be encountered grazing on their own. Rhinos like to rest in the shade, peacefully wallow in the water and mud to get rid of parasites, and to cool off as their skin size covers a large surface area. When grazing on short grass, they seem to move forward slowly, one step at a time, serenely enjoying the greenery as they go. White rhino drink water only every 2 to 4 days, and then will drink as most other animals do, either early in the morning or late afternoon. There seems to be no rush in their lives. Like their cousin, the black rhino, they are myopic, which means they are short-sighted. This deficiency is made up for by both an acute sense of smell and hearing. Ears can be rotated independently to ascertain noise direction. Sounds vary from soft grunts to high-pitched squeals. The rhino's constant companion is the red-billed or oxpecker, which helps control tick infestations. The birds are also the rhino's portable alarm system, their hissing calls warning of approaching danger. Cows are allowed to stray to other bulls' territories, but on return to its own herd, the visited bull will attempt to keep her with him. Fights occur seldom, and after huffing and puffing and mock attacks, males will leave each other be. Rhinos often rest on hillocks where they are exposed to cool breezes. The only enemy that the rhino has is lions in youth and man in maturity. White rhino cows come into estrus for the first time at 6 years. Thereafter, a gestation period of 16 months will produce a single calf. Newly born calves weigh about 50 kilograms. Females will have one calf only every 3 or 4 years and live to an age of 30 years. Rhino young can stand within an hour of birth. And for the first few days, the calf stays near the mother and usually walks in front of the mother, unlike that of its cousin. Juveniles have better vision, and maybe nature thought this appropriate for it to be in front, while short-sighted mom keeps in the background. Mothers nudge the calves in the right direction from the back by gently shoving the calf with her horn. After about 3 or 4 weeks of isolation, the mother and calf rejoin the herd. The calf starts grazing after about 2 months and weans after about 1 year. The horns on the white rhino can reach about 160 centimeters in length. Modern conservators often trim off horns to deter poachers. Horns are also used to insert intricate radio tracking devices.
Oh, my God.
lion. Remember to keep the vehicle windows closed and not to venture out of the vehicle in a lion's vicinity. They may look friendly and cuddly, but there could be one coming up from the rear of the vehicle, or a lion could be injured perhaps and decide to charge. If the elephant is king of the beasts, then the lion is the warlord. The rumbling roar of the lion in an African sunset sends a chill down our spine. They make sure that everybody knows who the boss is. Humans up to 8 kilometers away can, on a still night, hear a full lion roar crossing the plains. The Swahili tribe has a saying that the lion says, "Hi ni inchi yanani yangu yangu yangu," meaning, "Whose country is this? Mine, mine, mine." For the entire strength and powerhouse image, lions remain lazy. They spend 15 to 20 hours being inactive, resting and lying on their backs with all four legs dangling in the air. In early years, the lion was one of the most widely distributed animals in Africa. Their habitat stretched from Cape Town to Algiers in the north, Morocco in the east, and very far into the west. Both the Cape lion, which was very large, as well as the Barbary lion of North Africa, is now extinct. The lion is the largest of the African carnivores, with a powerfully built muscular body, an impressive blonde ginger or black mane on its neck, which can extend to shoulders and belly. The average adult male lion is about 3 meters in length, and the adult female about 2.5 meters in length, and they weigh 240 and 180 kilograms respectively. Yes, the lion is predominantly a hunter, sometimes a scavenger, and this team function is generally initiated by the female, who often goes for the kill herself. Their prey includes impalas, zebra, waterbuck, kudu, giraffe, wildebeest, and even buffalo. They are opportunists and will steal kills from other predators should the opportunity arise. When lions hunt, they stalk and spread out to try and surround their prey. Once a prey is isolated and determined, a short charge is made. Often these charges are unsuccessful. Lions very seldom charge for long distances. Consequently, if the prey can manage to outrun the lion for a length of time, the chances are good that he will not be caught. The prey may be killed in a variety of ways. For smaller species, a neck bite suffices. But for larger ones, the throat is often seized and strangulation follows if the actual bite does not kill. The victim may also have its nose or belly hooked by a lion's paw, while others attack the neck to strangle and fracture the neck. Some lions jump onto the animal, dig their teeth into the haunch, and by jerking upwards, break the victim's back. After meals, lions like to drink water, relax, and sleep. Like house cats, they will also preen. Cubs use this time to socialize and be among other adults. Lions are known for being able to go long periods without water, and if so, it approaches gingerly, as if fearing to get wet at the water's edge. They live in groups known as prides, which can vary between 4 to 30 individuals, and the size of the prides fluctuates according to the size of their area, as well as the abundance of game to capture. The more inaccessible the game, the better the survival rate of the cubs and all other members of the pride. Lions mark off their territory by urinating on trees, rocks, stumps, or other markers. This indicates to other lions that this particular territory is marked off for the exclusive use of the local pride of lions. You may have heard that lions are mostly active during the night. This is the main time when kills are made, pride business is attended to, and structure is reinforced in the pride. Lions are social animals and play with their cubs. They also groom one another. Other females will attend to cubs while their mother is away hunting. They even suckle cubs in the absence of their mother. During the mating ritual, the male will copulate every 20 to 30 minutes for 4 to 5 days. This is because the sperm count of lions is low, and hereby successful impregnation is assured. Gestation takes 108 days, and then usually 2 to 6 cubs are born. Cubs are usually born in a secluded thicket, bush or cave. They remain there hidden at first, while the mother lioness does the hunting. As the cubs get older, so they join the rest of the pride. They are weaned at 10 weeks, and are very close to their mothers until about 18 months. They are usually independent by about 2 years. Once cubs have been abandoned by their mothers, they may stay with the pride or move on and form their own pride. Man is the only enemy of the lion. Hyenas or even wild dogs may kill old and infirm lions or attack youngsters. Other males who have successfully taken over control of a pride will kill all the cubs to ensure the continuation of his bloodline. Lions eventually die of starvation as the loss of teeth at old age prevents the animal from hunting and feeding. Buffalo. Commonly also called the Cape buffalo, it is unfortunate that no more buffalo inhabit their ancient grazing fields within the Cape colony of old. One of the most impressive and frightening sights of Africa is the mighty steamroller stampede of herds of buffalo thundering across the savannah. Normally not aggressive, it is regarded as the most dangerous animal when wounded by its main natural enemies, lion and man. With its menacing curved horns held high, it will charge, lowering its horns at the last moment to fling its tormentor into the air. Watchers of buffalo are often amazed at the intelligence and cunning of the animal. An alarmed herd, threatened by packs of lions, has been seen to go into defensive semicircular formation, with females and calves within. Unprovoked, however, the buffalo is inquisitive and placid, and will stand and stare at you if you do not interfere. Directly threatened, it may sweep its massive head from side to side in a brief display of bravado, and then back off and retreat. Buffalo are primary grazers and like to drink at least twice a day. Sometimes you will see individuals cooling down in a mud pool or in the shade of a tree. At birth, buffalo calves weigh about 35 kilograms. At 1 year, weigh 220 kilograms, and at 3 years, about 500 kilograms. At 6 years, they weigh over 650 kilograms. Buffalo calves tend to grow by about half a kilogram per day for the first year. They then slow down a little as they are then producing teeth and are getting perhaps a poorer nutritional content. Growth stops at about 4 years for females and at about 6 years for males. Hunters have learned that the buffalo's heart lies more forward than it does in other game. It lies between the third to the sixth rib, ideal for a shot if the head is not clearly visible. Man already used this knowledge during early buffalo hunts. Buffalo occur in the north of Namibia, Botswana, Zimbabwe and southern Mozambique. The Addo Elephant Park and the Kruger Park have stocks of these powerful animals. These animals should not be mistaken for either the black or blue wildebeest, which are smaller in stature, and their horns do not meet on the skull. The buffalo is distinctly ox-like in appearance with heavily built features. The tail is dark brown and not fluffy as that of the wildebeest. Giraffe. Imagine three adult men standing on top of each other, and then you can picture the average height of an adult giraffe. Having your shoulders 3.5 and your head a full 6 meters above the ground means that nature has endowed this beautiful animal with remarkable traits. From the top down, the eyes instantly draw the viewer's attention due to the large and abundantly lashed eyelids. This pleasing and friendly feature is the start of the soft, delightful, and elegant perception portrayed to man by this animal. Africa is home to the giraffe. The eyes are positioned in such a manner in the skull and protrude at such an angle that the animal requires minimal head movement necessary to see in any direction. The pair of blunt protrusions from the head are not horns, but skin-covered hair protrusions. Some animals even have two sets of horns, borne by both male and female animals, one set smaller than the other. Its vascular system is so equipped that blood moving to the brain due to the long distance between the brain and the heart does so via arterial valves. These valves ensure that blood moving uphill cannot fall back due to gravity. Like humans, the giraffe has 7 neck vertebrates, which are however greatly elongated. Surprisingly enough, the common field mouse also has 7 vertebrates in its short neck. The long, flexible, dark, and long muscular upper lip are used to rip leaves from branches. They also eat twigs, fruit, and seeds. And like cows, they chew the cud, which is food that has entered the stomach but has been regurgitated to the mouth for a second chewing. Giraffes typically have chestnut-brown blotches against a buff background, markings that blend with dappled shadows of tree branches. Their backs slope from the shoulder to the rump, and as they age, their color grows darker brown. Each animal has individual markings which may be used for individual research recognition. Giraffes have a keen sense of smell, hearing, and an outstanding sense of sight. Giraffes gallop with the hind feet reaching in front of the forefeet and the neck swinging wildly, giving the appearance of slow motion. They are capable of running up to about 55 kilometers per hour, but are not leapers or jumpers like most other animals. Owing to their weight, which is about 900 kilograms for females and 1400 kilograms for males, they are unable to traverse boggy swamps or sandy riverbeds. On dry, hard land, they range for hundreds of kilometers from water. Unlike other animals, they do not migrate in winter because they get enough sustenance and moisture from leaves. They can go more than a month without a drink, and the few times they do drink, they must spread their long forelegs wide to reach the water. For this reason, giraffes very rarely graze grass. They emit a low, soft moan to communicate. They usually sleep in a standing position and are peace-loving animals. Lions are the chief predators but need to get past the vicious kicks dealt out by large, heavy hooves. These hooves are deadly and can kill lions. Crocodiles also present danger when drinking at waterholes. Feeding and movement takes place during the cooler parts of the day. Favorite trees can be noticed by the hourglass shape that forms due to regular cropping. An interesting fact is that overgrazed trees develop bitter tannins to reduce cropping, giving the plant an opportunity to recover from heavy grazing. The gestation period for giraffes is 15 months after which one calf is born. This birth is delivered in the standing position, and the calf falls about 1.8 meters to the ground. This is said to ensure separation of the umbilical cord. The calf is usually mobile within 20 minutes after birth, and they reach maturity at 5 years of age. Giraffes prefer savanna habitat where they graze predominantly on acacia species. They avoid very dense bush and forest. They move in herds of up to 30 individuals. Males fight for dominance by standing next to each other and by swinging their heads, ram their necks with the force of a collision that is audible kilometers away. Their horns are also sometimes used during an upward movement on the offender's neck. Giraffes are social animals and are often seen sharing their habitat with baboons, zebras, kudus, impala, and wildebeest. They interact socially by gently necking. This is evident especially when they are courting. Necking is a gentle, drawn-out stroking action. Impala. Impala are the most abundant animals and will most probably be your first sighting of game in the Kruger National Park. Called the rooibok or redbuck, in Afrikaans it is often mistaken to be a springbuck. They however have a higher stature and do not have the noticeable black strip on the side, which is commonly visible on the springbok. Their horns also differ from the springbok in that the latter's horns curve inward, while the impala's horns point upward in a curve to the rear. The underbelly is white, and from the rear the letter M is clearly visible on the rump. These dark markings are jokingly referred to as the McDonald's sign of nature, as they are, due to their abundance, one of the favorite targets for all carnivores. These gregarious animals move in herds numbering from a few to many hundreds of individuals. During the mating season, herd size will change as bulls isolate and defend females in estrus. Because they remain in herds, they benefit from others by collectively checking for danger from predators. Large herds also confuse predators, and only sick, old or lame individuals that cannot move at the pace of the herd, thus becoming prime targets during predator hunts. The first impala sensing danger is alerted, and immediately signals by snorting. This immediately alerts the rest of the herd. Instantaneously, one notices that all then stop grazing and look up to try and identify where the danger is coming from. They tend to look immediately in the direction of the first one who gave the snort. Once they notice the predator, they start moving away slowly. Sometimes individuals approach the predator to apparently get a better view. You may be lucky to see them on the run. This is exciting to watch as they sprint away by not running in a straight line, but dodging among the bushes, rocks and trees. This makes it more difficult for the predator to follow. As usually when a predator attacks, they go for the legs and rump. Notice how they constantly change their direction of flight, making it difficult for the predator. To add to confusion, the herd of impala scatter in all directions. Herds on the run are a sight to see, as they can leap up to 3 meters high in the air and jump up to 12 meters across obstacles. This makes it difficult for the predator to keep track of the prey. The herds are managed by the bachelor, and juvenile and female impalas belong to the superior male. Breeding takes place in autumn, and at this time intense rivalry builds up between adult males with loads of snorts and grunts. They will resort to threatening displays, horn thrusting, and occasionally fatal duels with each other. When a lone male impala intrudes upon an existing herd, it is allowed to pass through the herd untouched, providing he does not interfere and keeps his head lowered and his ears back. The others will then leave him alone and let him pass through safely. Dogs also do this too often. If he shows any interest in the female, he is quickly driven off by the dominant male. The impala is known as nature's high jump expert. This beautiful prancer has the grace of a ballet dancer, yet is extremely elusive and gentle. When moving slowly, you will notice that it moves with a slight hunched back while its tail presses tightly against its hindquarters. His ears flick frequently and lots of foot stomping also takes place. Impalas are hunted by hyenas, leopards, lions, cheetahs, jackals, wild dogs, pythons, and large eagles. Kudu. Kudu are immediately noticeable by their long twisted horns reaching up to 1.6 meters long and thin vertical white stripes in wavy vertical lines down the body and rump. They have large ears and a white stripe across the face from eye to eye. They have a white fringe of hair from the throat to the base of the neck. Their long twisted horns are more prominent on the male than on the female, who have no or very small horns on their head. Adults weigh up to 250 kilograms and live for about 15 years. They are normally active in the early morning and late afternoon, where they are seen at waterholes, where after they move on to grazing fields. During the heat of the day, they are difficult to spot as they tend to stand near dappled shade of trees, which offer an excellent camouflage. Observed in the open field, you will notice that they are very wary and ready to sprint away. The kudu is a gentle animal, preferring flight to fight. Enraged kudu bulls, however, at the height of the mating season, become very aggressive toward other males, often causing serious injury to each other. During these fights, horns sometimes get inextricably locked and both animals die an agonizing death. The kudu has the loudest call of any antelope and sounds like a penetrating hoarse bark. When they are frightened and flee, they lift their tails over their rumps and fan out a white undersurface as a warning signal to others. If sufficient cover is available, the animal tends to first access the situation and then only will dart away if they regard it as necessary. High fences are no deterrent to kudu. The long, arcing leaps of kudu over district roads has caused many a collision with vehicles, especially at night. They will graze on anything, even on crops and tobacco fields, making them widely hunted by farmers. They have no problem living on the fringes of human habitation. They mate between June and August, rearing their young in summer. When the calves are born, they are normally born and hidden in long grass to afford them the advantage of camouflage. For the first day, the mother will remain with the newly born and then later rejoin the herd. The cow regularly returns to the hidden spot till the calf is able to suckle on its own and move with the herd. This can take up to 1 month. Kudu are well known for jumping fences. They can jump 3 meters in height without a problem from a standing position. They feed both nocturnally and during the day, which means that they will be encountered walking around during a night safari. Kudu prefer grazing the leaves of certain trees. Grasses supplement this diet. Often one will notice that a kudu grazes for a short while from the leaves from a certain tree branch. It then moves on to either another branch, but usually to another tree. This is because many of the trees from which they eat become bitter when disturbed too much, and this causes the kudu to move on. Nature uses this reaction to prevent the kudu from eating all the leaves off the branch, thus protecting the tree from overgrazing and dying. Once trees exude these bitter tannins, they have time to recover from continuous grazing. Leaves are the producers of energy by means of photosynthesis, so they are vital in continued growth and health of the plant. Sometimes they are seen to dig up soil with their horns. This is part of the mating ritual. Kudu prefer savanna woodland with scrub forest and prefer moving close to rocky outcrops and riverbeds. Springbok. Springbok occur in the open grasslands and arid regions of Namibia, central and southern Botswana, and in the Northern Cape. They inhabit Karoo-like semi-arid regions, where the grass is low and the vegetation semi-arid. And like other antelope, they have successfully adapted to thrive in dry climates. Springbok is South Africa's national anthem and sports emblem. Sportsmen and women who have achieved the highest levels in sport are referred to as springboks. These animals are cinnamon brown in colour with a white underbelly. The white separated from the brown by a dark brown band on either flank. It has a white rump with a white tail and a tuft of black hair at the tip. The backs of the forelegs are white and the fronts of the hind legs are white. The springbok has a white throat and face with a dark brown line from the corners of the mouth to the eyes. These animals look very similar to the impala, but the white face and curved inward horns are easily identifiable. When in danger or through sheer joy, the springbok executes a series of balletic, stiff-legged high leaps known as pronking or stotting behavior. During this jump, the back curves out prominently. The springbok can leap over 3.5 meters high, a distance of 15 meters at full gallop reaches speeds of 90 kilometers an hour. This is, however, no match for predators such as lions, cheetahs and leopards, which are the traditional enemies of this fleet-footed antelope. Springbok are gregarious and often roam in groups of over 100 individuals. The dry months see them covering vast distances daily in search of grazing, and they associate loosely with animals such as wildebeest, blesbok and ostrich. While feeding, they often dig out roots and bulbs. Most springbok lamb are born in the rainy season when the grass is green and food plentiful. The mother hides her newborn offspring in bush or long grass for where a day or two it remains absolutely still. After 3 days, the lamb is able to flee when disturbed or threatened. Historians have often written about the renowned treks of the springbok. Thousands upon thousands of individuals would migrate over considerable distances, moving instinctively towards areas where rain had fallen. They are known to follow thunderstorms to firsthand enjoy new green shoots. These so-called tidal waves of animals are unfortunately not known today anymore. Springbok venison is highly regarded and is in demand both locally and abroad. South Africans love springbok biltong, which is a dried and spiced strip of meat, a real delicacy. These animals are ideally suited for game farming and be contained by ordinary fencing and have a high reproductive rate.